This room is empty now. Nothing remains but dust and sunlight and forgotten rubble. But 50 years ago, it was filled with workers sitting at their tables, rolling and cutting cigar leaves with their chavetas.
Ybor City began in the 1880s when Don Govino Gutierrez, a New York importer of fine foods, heard that there were guava plants in Tampa. His search revealed that the trees were too scattered to support a processing plant. But on his trip home, he stopped off in Key West to visit some old friends, Vicente Martinez Ybor and Ignacio Aya. These cigar manufacturers were having labor problems and planning to move their plants from New York City and Key West to Houston. Gutierrez suggested that they look at Tampa with its beautiful harbor and steamship service to Havana, where plant had just brought the railroad and where the climate was humid like Havana's, and they would be closer to their source of labor and tobacco. The men became very excited, and the three Dons traveled to Tampa right away. Ybor chose a 40-acre site just northeast of the city, but found that the price was too high and was ready to give up the project. When the Tampa Board of Trade heard about this, they immediately launched an emergency campaign and promised to raise one half of the purchase price. So anxious were the townspeople to save this chance for a new industry that donations of land and money poured in until the drive was successful. Meanwhile, Ybor learned that the only little bank in town was pulling up stakes, actually loading up their wagons to move to Jacksonville. He raced over to their office and told them he was going to build a factory with a payroll of $5,000 a week. It didn't take any time at all for them to start unloading their wagons, and the First National Bank was on its way. Ybor City has had many ups and downs in the 100 years since Gutierrez came looking for his guavas. I asked Tony Pizzo what he thinks of when he walks past the familiar scenes of his childhood.
Joyce, Ybor City means a lot to me. I was raised in Ybor City during the years when Ybor City was in its apogee. Everyone was so friendly. They all worked in cigar factories. They made good money, they dressed well, they ate well, and we had all the varieties of foods. That in itself was a lot of fun. And of course, when you'd walk through Ybor City, you could smell the fragrant tobacco as they were being turned into fine cigars, and you could smell bread baking and coffee roasting, and at the same time, your eye would be filled with beauty because the Spanish and Cuban and Italian senoritas would be walking up and down. From the very beginning, we have had clubs here. They actually started as mutual aid societies. The Latin people of Ybor City are very independent, and they were self-reliant. And during times of stress or sickness in the family, they knew that they would be taken care of. In those days, if you dated a Latin girl, you had to have a chaperone to go along with you. And I will always remember very fondly the tea dances on Sunday afternoon at the Centro Español and the Centro Asturiano. How beautifully the girls were dressed. We would be dancing, and regardless who you were dancing with, if you had an Italian partner, you'd be speaking Italian, or Cuban or Spanish, you'd speak Spanish, and of course we had Anglo-Saxons here too. But back in 1886, when Ybor and Aya established their two factories in Ybor City, things were very, very different. There were alligator holes infested with snakes. At night, the cigar makers had to wear goggles because the gnats were so bad. And not only that, they carried a lantern to see their way through the brush and watching out for alligators and stumps. They had just cleared the area. But Mr. Ybor was always trying to do things to keep them him happy. And He started building cottages for them, gave them an opportunity to become property owners, and that really tied them to the place. When it was close to Christmas, the first Christmas in 1886, traditionally the Cubans liked to go home for Christmas, and Havana and Key West being so close, they would go, they were planning to visit their relatives and spend the holidays. And Mr. Ybor was very worried. He knew that if they left, they probably would never come back. So he says, I don't want anyone to leave because I have a very big surprise for you. Comes Christmas Eve, day Eve, and he sent out carriages to pick up the families, take them to his estate, which was called La Quinta, located on 12th Avenue and 16th Street. And they had a wonderful time. But the big surprise of the day was when he divided among his workers the sum of $6,000.
After that Christmas, my maternal grandfather, Peter Pizzolatto, established a grocery store on this corner of 8th Avenue and 18th Street. The building was replaced by this modern structure in 1955. I was born in a small cottage right behind the grocery store, but I'm not going to tell you what year that was. It's still a family affair, and the business is being run today by my nephew, Paul Castellano.
Buongiorno.
Good morning, Paul. Thank you. Thank you very much. Food has always been important to Latin people. One of the most important is Cuban bread. Cigar Medina, one of Tampa's most famous bakers who never pulled a loaf out of an oven.
You're absolutely correct. I went into the Cuban bread business back in 1924, and I stayed producing Cuban bread in the same manner that you have seen here today. And I continued doing that until 1939 when I decided to go into the American bread business.
You know, Cesar, I well remember that because everybody in Ybor City thought you were a traitor converting from your bakery from Cuban bread to American bread. But you were really way ahead of the times because in time you became the chairman of the board of the National Wholesome Bakeries with 80 bakeries scattered all over America.
That was a wonderful experience and I'm very appreciative about the support that we've had from the people in Tampa. And of course, I'm still interested in the Cuban bread. And of course, you know this is being used extensively for the manufacturing of the famous Cuban sandwiches.
That's right.
Even today, thousands and thousands of the sandwiches are being sold, but of course the price has changed tremendously. When I was in that business many years ago, the Cuban sandwich that was made with ham and cheese on Cuban bread used to sell for a dime. Today that sells for close to a dollar and a half. And the complete sandwich in those days not only carried the ingredients that we have today, back in 1924 and 1930, but it had chicken and turkey.
That's right.
And sold for 15 cents. Today it sells for over $2, which goes to show what inflation has done in every phase of our life here in America.
See, though, one of the proofs of the popularity of Cuban bread is in the fact that when Teddy Roosevelt was here during the Spanish-American War, he was introduced to Cuban bread. And later on in years, when he became president of the United States, a Tampa delegation went up to Washington to invite him to visit Tampa. The first question he asked was, is Cuban bread still available in the restaurants?
Well, of course, that's probably the first thing that the tourist that comes to Tampa today is always very fond of, and he really does not find that anywhere in the United
Cesar,
States.
I've seen people at the airport with arms full of loaves of Cuban bread getting on the
plane. All over the United States.
That's right.
And the community has thought so much of that they've decided to buy one of the local bakeries and make a museum so that they can show the tourists from now on how Cuban bread has been one of the vital things in this area, to the extent that in this area, the two most important things for the people of Ybor City has been Cuban bread and have available Cuban coffee.
Smell that aroma, Cesar.
That is really beautiful. That black and strong coffee that a lot of people think is injurious actually is much better for you than the American coffee, because that black coffee is that way because the bean has been roasted much longer, and that way the injurious part of the bean, the caffeine, has been greatly eliminated. So that coffee actually should be more advantageous for people to drink than the coffee that we're drinking today that we call American coffee.
That's interesting.
It is.
Cesar, coffee has been a big thing in the lives of the Latins of Ybor City. In the early days, there were coffee shops all over the area. And of course, the coffee shop was a social center. In the evening, the cigar makers would go home, refreshing themselves, have dinner with their wives and family, and then would kiss the señora, adios, and off he'd go to the corner coffee shop. And this is one way he showed his real true machismo, you know, independence. And they'd have coffee there, sometimes even above some of these coffee houses, there were boarding houses for the bachelors. And they'd come down and have Spanish bean soup or a Cuban sandwich and enjoy their Cuban coffee.
I remember that very well, because at that time I was very young, around 13 or 14, and I was working as a part-time waiter in one of these so-called boarding houses. And the people that I used to serve were very demanding, but they were paying a fantastic figure for their meals. Three meals a day, 7 days a week, $5. They insisted in having their soup lleno, which meant that it had to be filled to the brim.
Right.
And if it wasn't done that way, they would become very unhappy. So I remember that very, very well.
Very interesting, Cesar. Cesar, have you ever stopped to think of the coffee break? It actually originated in Ybor City, in the cigar factories, and it's become an institution nationwide.
And of course, even though the coffee break has been a tradition, especially today, that has not changed as far as the Spanish workers are concerned. Not too many weeks ago, one of the large bakeries here the people wanted to go on strike in the middle of the night because there was no coffee available, and the owner had to rush out and get the coffee, otherwise the men wouldn't continue working.
Coffee still is a way of life, isn't it?
Right. Well, Caesar, some things have changed. Today you go to the bakery to buy your bread, but in the old days, Cuban bread would be delivered unwrapped, and there'd be a nail next to the door, and the bread delivery man would slam that bread right on that nail. And of course, you know that the traditional breakfast of the Latins of Ybor City is café con leche. So the family would sit down, have their coffee and Cuban bread with butter, and the cigar makers would be off to work, and the children would go on to school.
Caesar, this village certainly brings back old memories. This is where I started grammar school. And I remember so well when I used to line up here with the rest of the kids going up to class. See, I remember that in those days, you know, we were Spaniards, Cubans, Italians attending this school.
Right.
And there were a lot of roughnecks. There were a lot of fights in these, right around this building. And the principal had his hands full, and the teachers did too. But one of the real hobbies of the kids was playing hooky. And one of the things they used to do was go to Tingaling, which was nothing but a ditch near the Seaboard Airline shops. And of course, after a while, they found out that we had a hangout out there, and the truant officer, Mrs. Bass, used to chase us down. They were really happy moments.
Not only did they go out there, but a lot of the boys and girls, boys mostly, went out to La Draga, which is at the foot of 14th Street.
That's
which
right.
Is now the estuary.
The estuary, and certainly. I used to go there too.
That was the only swimming pool that the kids around here had in those days.
That's so true.
That's right.
So things have really changed, Caesar. Of course, you know, Mr. Ybor, in the early days, he had a philosophy about child labor. There were no laws then in existence, but he had a policy that if a child didn't attend school, they could not work in the factories. And this was at the very beginning. And the first school, as you know, was what they used to call the free school, located on 8th Avenue and 14th Street, with Mrs. Greer being the teacher. And all the grades from the first to the sixth were taught at that same, within that same building.
Well, you see, the thing that was very interesting in the way of education in those days is that the adults who came here came from Cuba and Spain and Italy and what have you, had not had the benefit of hardly any education.
Very true.
Yet, within a short time, they were able to achieve as being recognized as the best informed workers in America, because they developed a philosophy of hiring an individual who they were willing to pay themselves. Management didn't pay it. That used to call them elector. And this was an individual that would stand or sit in the middle of the hall and read to them all the news of the previous day in the morning paper, and then in the afternoon he would read from some of the best books of English, American, and Spanish literature. Well, you know, the lector, as a matter of fact, was a VIP. He used to go to work about 9 o'clock in the morning, and he would read for 2 or 3 hours, and then he would take a rest to prepare himself for the afternoon session, where he would go into the literary part of the reading. And in those areas, he would try to imitate the voice of the different actors, men, women, and children.
He was really an actor, wasn't he?
That's right. And in many cases after that, when the reading was discontinued, they went on to New York and other cities and participated in the stage.
Aparicio was one of them, I remember.
One of them, yes. And many others.
And Chicharito was another one.
That's another one.
Was very successful.
And you know, it's an amazing thing to me that after all these years, when I was very young, as I walked through Ybor City and I passed some of these factories today, the mind is such a tremendous thing that I can almost hear the voice of my father as if he was reading today in those factories.
Las tumbas tienen por lenguaje las flores de...